You know, tomorrow needs to be for you an opportunity so the Holy Spirit can take you and train you. Tomorrow, no matter what kind of work or what kind of press may be upon you, demands that may be upon you by this cruel society, you could just separate yourself unto the Lord while you're doing your task. Don't get too carried away with making somebody wealthy who's just going to spend it promoting the devil. You understand what I'm saying? Do your task, be faithful. God will bless fruits. God will bless the work of your hand, but don't get all wrapped up in yourself, trying to be some superstar for men at the expense of just putting God on hold. You understand what I'm telling you? Do you understand what I'm trying to express to you by the Spirit of God? Because if you'll begin to trust in God, begin to let God work through your life, not only will He make you, give you a better ability to do what it is you're doing and favor among those. Come on. They bound, think about this. The scripture says they bound Joseph with chains and put a yoke of fetter about his neck. They put a yoke upon his neck, a big old neck chain around him, and stuck him into prison. Huh? And I'm telling you, there's no TV, no three meals, huh? And some soft cushiony cot. It was a dungeon. You know, of the worst kind back in those days. And it wasn't even too far long ago, 300 years ago, 200 years ago. You can look at the dungeons then and understand how terrible that thing was that he was in. There he gave himself to seeking God. There's no doubt about it. He gave himself to seeking the Lord. He gave himself to the interaction that he had begun to be taught by his father, Jacob. So the father was able to bring him up out of that pit, to loose the fetters that bound him, the chains and the yoke that was on him, and set him in the highest place. God, if God could take a man from the midst of complete and total rejection and disdain on death row, you can't be in worse sorts. You cannot be in worse standing with men. That's what I'm trying to tell you, than Joseph was there. Cannot be. If God could take a man from such a state and promote him to be the prince over all of the world, what would God do to you and me? What could God do to you and me if we would just start trusting him? Stop pursuing our own interest and going after it. Just do your best. Do what you do. Just do your best and leave the rest. Do you hear me? Just do your best and leave the rest. Huh? Don't let it get in the way of you seeking God and obeying God and doing what God has set us to do as his representatives in the earth. Tomorrow, give yourself to this training ground in the Holy Ghost. Tuesday, give yourself to these things. Give these things to. Give yourself to these things of the Spirit. Let God begin to show you and form in you an agreement with him so that you can say no to sin and no to the wrong choices and no to the things that would rob you of this divine power and glory. And then by Wednesday, you're about ready for another meeting. I believe that if we just keep people in the meeting every night, you know, it's a wonderful thing about Bible school and being able to be in the meeting every day and be trained in the Word every day and flow in the Holy Ghost every day. You don't get rusty. Hallelujah. 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 Just think about it. The Lord loved to be able to teach you how to rejoice in the midst of the prison. He did love to teach you how to rejoice in the midst of and seek him and rely upon him and trust him and be confident in him. Shows us so confident. What reason did he have to be confident in God? He was bound with chains and a yoke was about his neck. And he was done in a filthy dungeon, in a dark room. And everybody would say, by those circumstances, abandoned by God. But he remained confident in God so that he could say to the butcher, and he could say to the cupbearer, tell me your dreams. The God of heaven will reveal them to me. Wow. He said, well, what did I do wrong? Where did I fail? Oh, to let God become in charge of your life. To recognize that anything that you're doing right now, it's God, a divine opportunity that God has given you to train you. And he knows how to grab a hold of you wherever you're at and take you out of that place and promote you into something far more glorious and far more meaningful in the kingdom. But you got to be willing to be trained right where you're at right now. You got to be willing to put God first there. You got to be willing to let God develop confidence in you where you're at right now. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, rababa, say tasty. I'm Ramon, no casicilia till first. You know, listen, don't get me wrong. I'm so happy. I'm so blessed with the presence and the glory of the Lord that's here in this place. It just, you know what? You walk with God and the move of God keeps getting defined for you in higher terms. It begins. The move of God, the moving and the outworkings of the Spirit of the Lord begins to have for you a greater expression of his divine power and glory. This is what you and I are supposed to be involved in. This is what you and I are supposed to be participating in. Hallelujah. And it's the excitement of waking up in the morning. We're getting ready to have an encounter. Monday morning. Actually, in God's terminology, it's day two. It's Yom Shishi, day two. It's really not Moon Day. Unfortunately, that was always named, all these days were named after gods, foreign gods, the worship of foreign gods. Sad, isn't it? And I'm not going to go into all of that. With God, it's just day one, Yom Echad. Day two, Yom Shishi. Day three, Yom Shilosh. Day four, Yom Arba. You know, day five, day six. And then the only one he named was Shabbat. He named that the rest. Day one, day two, day three, day four, day five, day six, rest. Day one, day two, day three, day four, day five, day six, rest. Day two tomorrow, day one. We're starting day one good. We're starting day one good, huh? Come on. Day one's good. Praise God that our government and the way that things are designed in business still participates with us being able to just have the day off to seek God. Isn't that great? What a blessing. Day two ought to be seeking God too. Day one set the precedence. Day two ought to just feel right on in and follow through. Are you with me? Day three ought to be there too. Day three ought to be better. Day four should be even more glorious. Day five, through the roof. Day six, you're about to explode. Day seven, a whole new height than God. Huh? Then day one again, reset. Reset to a new height, a new standard, a new dimension of flow, a new expectation of faith, a new authority in God, a new means by which now you speak to mountains and they just jump out the way. A new height, a new breadth, a new length, a new depth, a new, as it were, revelation and discovery of God's love. And the fullness of all that he's made available to us. And that fullness just keeps getting fuller. And bigger. And high, just keeps getting higher. Amen. Shoo. Shoo. Deep calls unto deep. Let me hear the melody just a little bit, will you? I just want you to separate the apparatus. I didn't want you to let them all sit right there. I just want you to let them let the expression, let the expression of the Holy Ghost come out of you right now. It's not that hard. If you don't know how to have the, there's some other expressions you could have: joy, a smile, happy, rejoicing, praise, love, peace, ta, goodness, glory, haramande, all these things of heaven. It's too long. We've been just talking about them all. Now let's just go ahead and do them. Let's 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 do them. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Well, I want you to be ready, people. I want you to be ready because God's going to bring you across the... He's going to have you cross paths with people tomorrow that he's sending you as a messenger and an ambassador to them because he loves them so much. And there's not any way that I can tell you what all God would, all the diverse things that God may say through you to them. He may just tell them how much he loves them, or how he desires to fellowship with them, to reveal himself to them. Who knows what all God's going to say? But I'm telling you, he sends you as a messenger, not an ambassador, on his behalf to a lost and dying world, people that are backslidden, people who just love him and are serving him best that they know and understand. And he wants to open up a door of greater revelation and fellowship to them. And you and I, and what we have in God, what we know in God. And now we're talking to a woman about some cows. And she was getting baptized in the Holy Ghost. I kid you not. We also begin to talk to her about her soul and about her heart and about her state and about her life. In a way of compassion and mercy. Come on. It doesn't matter what the topic is. God, the Holy Spirit wants to move through you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. You know, you're sitting on an airplane, for example. Your computer is a full-on evangelistic tool. You can open up to a certain passage and put it on like 21 font or 50 font. And then what you do, you just kind of turn the computer in your lap towards the person. And you just kind of like fall off to sleep and you can preach while you're sleeping. And they won't feel awkward looking over your shoulder and seeing it. It's a message from heaven right to them, and it's sneaking up on them. Huh? Because they're reading it. You hear me? And then you're all set up by God. You got a little rest. And you wake up, and you know you're ready. The stage has been set. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Stage has been set. Seat has been sown. And you ready to pick some fruit. You ready to water some seed. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. People, if there's anything that you want to be able to do, you want to begin to, not just walk. Yeah, just a little more. I can see, I can still hear him. I can still hear the Lord saying, deep calls unto deep. And from the rock, he brings forth water. I can still hear him say. I hear him saying it. Because it's his word. It's what he's done. It's not hard to hear from God. It's real easy. All I got to do is start enjoying him. People try too hard. That's doubt and unbelief. Just step in. Just start. Father, I'm amazed at the abundant life that you've given me. I mean, when you give life, you don't hold anything back, do you? Huh? When you give joy, I'm telling you, don't give me just a little. And as you begin to thank him for it and praise him for it, you know what happens? the expression of it comes stronger because you're agreeing with God. When you're agreeing with God, what are you doing? Moving in faith. When you're agreeing with God, when you're praising Him in agreement with Him and obedience, whoo, to Him. Mahasatera. People, quit letting Satan intimidate you and lie to you. There's demonic powers at work in every walk of life, in every city, every town, every nation. But I'm going to tell you right now, the glory of God's bigger. Don't hide away and cower behind whatever it is, that intimidating, lying demon spirit. Be emboldened by the Spirit of the Lord. Be made just so confident in God. Did you read my Facebook post? Can somebody bring my Facebook post up for me real quick while I'm talking so that I can read it? Anybody read my Facebook post before I got here? Before you got here? Huh? Knowing that God hears you. Knowing that He revealed Himself as the God who hears us. You know, I love taking verses of Scripture and just writing them out, boom, 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 all on the same subject, and just let them speak for themselves. It is an hallelujah. First one there. Thank you, dear. I was wondering who was going to win the race. Hallelujah. You hit the Seymour. I'm always on the Seymour. For there is not a word in my tongue, but lo, Lord, You are completely aware of it. And if we know that He hears us, whatever we ask, we know that we have in our possession those things that we've desired of Him. For the Lord hears the poor. The Lord is far from the wicked, but He hears the prayer of the righteous. Whew. If you know He hears you. If you know He hears you. Know that the Lord has set aside them that are godly for Himself. The Lord will hear when I call unto Him. The eyes of the Lord are upon the righteous, and His ears are opened to their cries. If you know that He hears you. If you know that He hears you. Whatever you ask of Him is yours. You possess it. This is the assurance that God wants to give you. This is the confidence that God wants to give us. People always looking and trying to have something. Give me a break. Quit trying. This is who He is. Start agreeing with who He is. Start praising Him for who He is. The Lord is nigh unto them that call upon Him. To all that call upon Him in truth. He will fulfill the desires of them that fear Him. He also will hear their cry and will save them. And it shall come to pass that before they call, I will answer. And while they yet are speaking, I will hear. If you know that He hears you. Come on. If you could just begin to believe God and enjoy Him and agree with Him and get excited about who He is and what He's doing. Come on. You know that He hears you. And while they are yet speaking, I will hear. Therefore, I will look unto the Lord and I will wait for the God of my salvation. My God will hear me. God wants you to have some confidence, people. God wants you to draw near to Him with a true heart and full assurance of faith. A true heart that He made true. A faith that He gave you a measure of. That He can develop and grow and mature because you're willing to stand there and just rejoice over Him and in Him, because you're never going to figure out why He did it or how He did it, because He's just too big to ever figure out. He passes all those who can understand beyond all that you can think or ask. That's who God is. Hallelujah. Woo! Hallelujah! Lord, You have heard the desires of the humble. You will prepare their heart. You will cause your ear to hear, or you will make your ear to listen. Isn't that amazing? He can't refuse it. He can't refuse it. I cried unto God with my voice, even unto God with my voice, and he gave ear unto me. If you know that he hears you. I know that he hears me. I don't need any proofs. I don't have to have any test. God is proof enough. His word is all the test I need. My voice. I cried unto God with my voice. Even unto God with my voice, and he gave ear unto me. My voice you shall hear in the morning, O Lord. In the morning will I direct my prayer unto you, and I will look up. He that planted the ear, shall he not hear? He that formed the eye, shall he not see? Somebody said, well, what passage is that? That's about 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21 passages. Excuse me for a few minutes while I just enjoy him. Hallelujah. Is this one yours?
No.
Hallelujah. Prosade. It's a wonderful thing to be accepted in the beloved. Not try to be accepted anymore. It's a wonderful thing to be a part of God's family and be kept by the power of God and say you have to work so hard to keep yourself. It's a wonderful thing to be having been made pleasing unto God instead of you trying to put all the effort towards pleasing him. Whew. If our heart condemns us, God is greater. But if our heart doesn't condemn us, or if we have confidence towards God, then we know whatever we ask him, he will do it. Why? Because we keep his commandments and do that which is pleasing in the sight. How? By the strength of our own human ability and efforts? No. By flowing in the Holy Ghost. By flowing in the river. By living in the glory of his reign. Lord, let your glory fall like rain. Let your rivers, Holy Ghost, flow like rivers through me. Let your anointing go before me and break off every yoke. Be to me a sun and a shield. Oh God, my exceeding great reward, my strength, oh God. I always see you before me and on my right hand that I should not be moved. Oh God, I know that you hear me, that you always hear me, that I am your dwelling place, the tabernacle that you please to inhabit. Come on, baby. You listen, thinking, listening to the wrong stuff, thinking about the wrong things, having the wrong perspective, who you are and what you're meant to be. You'll never find happiness there. And you live out your life to be something. God has called you to a vocation. God has called you to a lifestyle. And he says, walk worthy of the vocation whereunto that you're called. And how am I going to walk worthy? Flowing in the river. How am I going to walk worthy? Moving in this wonderful realm of praise and thanksgiving. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I tell you, it's a wonderful thing to break the silence in an elevator and just say, God is so good. Or to say, thank you, Lord Jesus, for this. It's been a great, glorious day. Raining outside, lightning. Isn't it been a wonderful day? This is the day that the Lord has made. See, you can say it in such a way people feel awkward. But you know what's going to happen? They'll feel the anointing upon them because they've done encountered God through you. They might look all strange at you and be say, this doesn't fit into what we believe is right because they live in a prison in a dark realm. But you, the light, you, the voice. Crying out in a wilderness of sin, death, and destruction. The voice of God speaking and calling out to a people who do not know him, have not heard him.
And just by the sound of your praise, have an encounter. They might back away. They might look at you like you're weird, but they're going to walk out of that elevator or that encounter, and they're going to feel different. They're going to feel something.
I remember people telling me who later on God used me to bring into the kingdom that I didn't even know when I first encountered them. And they tell me, I searched all over for you. I went back to the place I first saw you. Huh? I just gave him a Holy Ghost hello. How are you? Something real simple from heaven. Something real simple from heaven. I promise you, people, there's more on the inside of you than what you've ever realized. God's come to inhabit you. God's come to dwell on the inside of you. Society and culture and man and the ideology and the philosophies and the traditions of men would impose upon you their own identity, which everybody's captivated in and walking in, and they've segregated themselves into the various different choices and the various different ideas and their various different skill sets. But I'm going to tell you right now, God's called every man everywhere out of that place to come into a place alone with Him, a place of great boldness and confidence that you can speak to a mountain and it'll obey you. You can say to a sycamine tree, be plucked up and planted over here in the sea. Whatever you say to God, give me Cuba. I'm opening up the door right now to speak to the president, to the leaders of that nation, to Castro's. Whatever it is. Whatever it is. Pain has to obey you. Devils have to obey you. Nothing holds you back. Nothing hinders you. Nothing stops you. Nothing distracts you. It's not about anything but God and doing His will and interacting with Him and walking with Him. Praise is the most sacred and holy thing. And I'm telling you, it's got to come back to that place where it once was. Because it's holies of holies. And oh, it should be a shout and it should be joyful, but it should be so sacred. What does that mean? It means it's true, it's pure, you're locked in with God. It's only about you talking to Him and not anyone else. Nothing else. You're not getting caught in the mechanics of it or the expressions of it, but just the shout of it. Somebody said, you know, I didn't know the words. I'm going to tell you right now, It may not be the right words for you at the time, but it's always the right music. You can have your own words. There are many times I'll stand on the platform, I'll turn off the microphone, I'll just sing my own words because I'm going to lock in with God. I'm not going to lock in with a song. I will not lock in with a song. I will lock in with God. I will not miss out on worship. I love it when the words and everything else that is going on, hallelujah, has is set in its proper settings. I'm going to tell you right now, here's what goes on. As you encounter God, as you move forward with Him, as you allow the increase to come in your life, you've got a new definition of what it means to interact with Him. You've got a new definition of what the encounter looks like. Hallelujah. It isn't quieter either. It's more explosive. It isn't less expressive. It's more extravagant. Hallelujah. The river's not flowing in a still place. It's coming from a high mountainous place. It's a wild river. Hallelujah. Praise God. And from the And from the rock salvation from the rock salvation for deep For deep calls unto thee.
from the wellspring. From the wellspring. This is what we want, Father. This is what we desire. And tomorrow, God is going to assay that. He's going to test that. He's going to look to participate with you that he may grow that and strengthen that and mature that. And he's going to allow you to be tested. He's going to allow the enemy to bring temptation your way. But it won't be above what you're able to turn away from or bear. Trial is going to come your way. Can you imagine for a moment with me? The steel, the gold, the frame that Joseph was made of. That he could be tested as he was. As the deep called unto deep, as the wellspring brought forth water through his life, salvation. Brought forth healing and deliverance through him. As God used him and promoted him to save a world and provide for his nation, who was very small, just a few in number. When I look at that, I understand what God, what the inheritance of God and the blessing of God puts upon a man. He received an inheritance and a blessing from his grandfather, great-grandfather, Abraham, that flowed into his grandfather, Isaac, that came upon the head of his father, Jacob, that also came unto him. And you and I tonight, we sit in this place with an inheritance and a blessing that's come right to us, firsthand, first generation, from the living God, our brother, our co-inheritor. What steel, what gold, what frame that would make. Oh, that God's people will step out all the way beyond the realms of human comfort, beyond the confinements of that human ability that each man is born with and endowed with, to now begin to function in the supernatural working and operation of the Holy Ghost that has come into our life. To be so excited about what Jesus is doing, you're not going to be in the comfort of the boat that you've been using as the last fragment of life to hang on to. The only thing that was stood between you and death, some little boat that was about to be flooded and sink at any moment. Suddenly see Jesus in the realms of his glory and say, bid me come. Bid me come. So the church begin to cry out to Jesus today and begin to say, bid me come. Bid me come. Bid me come. Speak the word only. A revelation would come to you and to me. A shout of glory. We get conflicted. The word of God gets choked. We get compromised by the stuff that comes around us and that we've legitimized and we've made okay. Oh, it's time to be with total abandonment, all in. Who, having been crucified, having died, been buried, hallelujah, having been raised up to a heavenly life, to the very life of the living God, hallelujah, with boldness and confidence, knowing I know that he hears me. Jesus gives us the example of knowing that he hears us. When he stood there in John chapter 11, and we know that John, as he's writing the first epistle of John in chapter 5 and verse 14 and 15, we know that this moment has been stamped upon his life. It's impressed upon his heart. He'll never forget it. He was standing there beside Jesus, completely overwhelmed with divine power and glory, shocked out of his mind. He just seen something that was completely beyond anything anyone could think could happen. A man who's been in the grave 3 days, whose body is already deteriorating. He sees Jesus stand there. Father, I know that you always hear me. Oh, look at the walk of people. God has called us to someplace so glorious. Come on. Break the restraints of religion. Break the restraints of all your tradition. Break the, redefine it according to how God has revealed it. He says, come on into this glory. Nothing profane can come. You know, I just finished a model of the third temple. And I love staring at it because I look through every doorway and all you can see is the altar. Every doorway, there's the altar. Every entrance, it's the altar. Everything converges upon the altar, the sacrifice. And that's the entryway into the glorious realm of the holies of holies. It's there facing the east. So at the rising of the sun, all the gold that is trimmed with and the beauty that God has fashioned it with begins to light up and shine. And it's all set up to where that light converges right on the entryway into the divine. Jesus, that door. Can you imagine that the door's not just open, waiting for you and I to discover its entrance? He's there banging on the doors of our hearts, saying, please don't be lukewarm no more. I can't fellowship with you like that. Don't be interested in other things anymore. I can't fellowship with you like that. Don't be distracted with your own cares and interests. Don't be caught up in all the things that Satan so subtly attacks you with, your strife, your envy, your debate, your confusion, your offense, your self-defense. I can't fellowship with you like that. Let me in. I'll come in with the glory of heaven, the glory of the ages. I'll come in with all the power that created and formed the universe. Jesus begging. Jesus begging. Begging. Pounding the door. While many times so many people ignore him or maybe even tell him to go away. I don't think anybody. No, I'm sure no one in this place has told him to go away. You've just been so distracted with the interest you didn't know. God's calling us, people. God's calling us. Listen, wherever God's placed you at right now, none of you are in a dungeon. It may feel like your job, your workplace, the things that you're in may feel like a dungeon, but none of you are fettered with chains. None of you have a clamp around your neck. In a dark, damp place. Is disease ridden. You can worship God where you're at. You can serve Him where you're at. You can have great confidence and boldness in Him. Not waiting for another moment. Just living, enjoying right now in Him. Hallelujah. I'm telling you right now. These things will happen in your spirit. These things are happening in your spirit right now. These things will begin to take place in your life. Some people say, well, why does the meeting have to go so long? Because it's necessary. Because it's necessary. The meeting needs to go all day. Everybody right now in Israel and that are Orthodox Jews and some even that are just even Reformed Jews, they're all blowing the trumpets and shouting right now. This is Yom Teruah, the day of shouting, or what some people call Rosh Hashanah, the head of the year, but it's not the head of the year. Passover is the head of the year. That was the traditional break from what God revealed. It's a festival and a feast on the first day of the seventh month that God didn't reveal what it's for other than just to shout. And Trump is blasting. And so from this, people begin to believe, oh, it's the head of days because it's the day of judgment. It's the day of the trumpet blast, the day when God calls all men, all souls to come into an account for the life that he gave them, for the life that he entrusted to them. To find out what spirit they are of, to try them as being of God or being of the rebellion. This is a day of shoutings. They're all shouting right now. Somebody said, are you going to celebrate the day of shoutings? What do you mean? I'm living in the day every day. I'm shouting every day. Amen. Well, I better be, because I done said I was. It's my testimony. I'm shouting this trumpet blast and praise. Shout to the Lord with a voice of triumph. Let all the people of the Lord say amen. Blow a trumpet in Zion. Sound an alarm in my holy mountain. We will rush on the city. We will climb up the wall. Great is the people. Great is the army that carries out His word. His word. His word. His word. His word. His word. If you know that He hears you. If you know that He hears you. It's a fellowship, it's a relationship, it's a consecration. It's a turning away from sin, it's a turning away from rebellion. It's not allowing anything emotional, it's not allowing anything human or physical to stop you or to keep you or prevent you from this place of praise. You're just a vessel. And it grows stronger and stronger and stronger to where it's such a blast of heaven through you. Ha ha ha. That if you were sick or weak or downtrodden, you can immediately begin to just whisper, Jesus. And out of that utterance begins to produce a river. Wellspring. Oh, wellspring. From the wellspring. It's true. So from the rock. You speak to the rock. You say, Jesus. And all of a sudden, the heavenly glory that this word of God describes, that everybody wants to just sit around and memorize the verse of scripture and talk about someday and talk about how much they love God, talk about how much they are yielded to Him and faithful to Him. Yet there is no real true expression of that growth and maturation of joy divine and joy unspeakable and full of glory, of a peace that passes understanding, of a love that flows with the same glory, the same beauty, the same splendor, the same power of Father's own love manifested in Jesus. A dear friend of mine, preacher friend of mine, I've known all my life, known him all of his life. Today he Facebooked Jesus' father selfie. It's true. Jesus' father's selfie. The image, the glory. God purposed that all the fullness of the Godhead, the divine power, should exist in Him bodily. And we're called, you and I, to this wonderful place in Him that He's commanding, that we ourselves be conformed to such an image. Wow! There would be, it's beyond my or thinking or understanding that God would even say such a thing. And Jesus is the express image of the fullness of God. My, we've allowed the lies and the tricks of the enemy to entangle us into all kinds of false identities, wrong vocations, crazy, weird, and wild concerns and imaginations that will perish and be destroyed forever. Only the Word of God will stand. That's how radical this is. That's how defined this is. That's how real it is. Are the only thing that remain. Everything will melt, pass away, destroy with fervent heat. The only thing that will remain is the Word of God. It abides forever. A word that you and I have been privileged not only to know mentally, to be able to think of and be reminded of, but that brings revelation and understanding that that expression of the Word of God may be actually revealed in us, that it works effectually in us to reveal this wonderful divine revelation and proclamation and definition and declaration of the purposes of what God the Father has said and done and willed and is. I want you to look at a verse of scripture with me here in Hebrews. Activate it. You know, I was telling somebody the other day, by the time I was 30, I had written a lot of songs. Actually, I kept them in a log and in a notebook up until that time in my life. It was a lot. I was at a place one time, and I don't mean this to be self-serving, I'm going somewhere with it. I just want you to know, I just written a lot of songs. I was at a place listening to a song, and I go, wow, that's a beautiful song. And somebody started laughing and said, yeah, you wrote that song. I'm like, I did. But then there came a point in time, I didn't write it down anymore. Because for me, for the most part, it was meant to be sung once. And it was sung in such a way that everybody would be swept away with that expression. God will use the expression of the song that you sing and anoint it so with His glory that everybody will be swept away into the beauty and the worship and the glory of it. And don't try to reproduce it. Don't try to copyright it. Don't try to stamp it with your little name. Somebody asked me and said, well, what about this particular song? Can we do it? I said, are you kidding me? It's open heavenly domain. It belongs to the Holy Ghost. Come on, people. We're just going to have to start living this. I remember one time, I thought I preached a really good sermon. I was young. In the ministry, I thought I preached a really good sermon, and I memorized it because it was so good. I wanted to capture it and reproduce it, and I tried to reproduce it, and it was the worst sermon I ever preached. It went from the greatest sermon that I ever preached to the worst sermon I ever preached, and God taught me a wonderful lesson at that moment in my life, and none of this could be reproduced by you. You can't copyright it. You can't figure it out. You can't make it happen. You can't reproduce it. You can't replicate it. You gotta walk with me. And let me give it to you, and I'm gonna give it to you better than you've ever heard it before. Just hang in. Hang on. Walk with me. That song you sang, that just getting you ready for the next one. It's going to be better. That prayer you prayed, it was preparation for you to pray a little bit deeper, a little bit truer, a little bit purer, a little bit more radical. Hallelujah. Come on, people. I love this verse of scripture in a very positive way. Here in Hebrews chapter 12, let me get it. Hallelujah. 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 Blessed is the name of the Lord. You know, I can quote it. I quote it to you this morning, but sometimes I have a hard time finding it. And, you know, I'm just looking for having received the heavenly gift, made partakers with the Holy Ghost, huh? Tasted of the good word of God. Where's that at? Can you help me find it? Can anybody see it so I can show you? I just want you to read it with me. Huh? Pardon? Is it chapter 6? Am I halfway off? Twice off? Oh, yeah. For we who are enlightened. I'm looking at it in the positive sense. I don't want to look at it in the negative sense. Are you with me? We have been enlightened. Say, I've been enlightened. The eyes of my understanding have been opened. The eyes of my understanding have been opened, and I am able to see this inheritance that He has in me. I'm enlightened. I understand who God is and who I am in Him. I am enlightened. I've tasted of the heavenly gift. I'm a partaker of the Holy Ghost. I mean, I'm a partaker. I'm a partner. I'm a participator. I've been joined. I've been united together with Him. My spirit is joined unto Him. I am the place where He dwells. I am His habitation. I'm His tabernacle. I'm His temple. I don't need to go on pilgrimage to Jerusalem. I'm in the temple right now over here. Hallelujah. I mean, think about it. Listen to one thing. And tasted the good word of God and the power of the world to come. That's what I'm experiencing. Hello.
You mean you can't enjoy all that? That don't sound like a good time. I'm not talking about walking away from it. I'm not, because it's impossible to renew such a one who denies that, who goes and says, there's nothing to it, it wasn't real, and rejects it. I'm just talking about getting a revelation of accepting what God has done for you and who you are in Him. Because there's a great confidence here. This is a place of communion and fellowship. This is a place where you see Him always before you on your right hand, that you should not be moved. Where Father sees, where He beholds. What is that like? Let's go with me there. Look at Psalms 139. Just go to Psalms 139 with me for a minute. This is a good one for you right here. Talk about something to put up in front of you when you feel all by yourself. God wants to make us of such stamina, of such persuasion, that no matter what goes on, we know who we are. We know what God will do on our behalf. We know the place that we've been given in Him. No circumstance or situation can in any way threaten that. No height, no depth. Nothing present, nor anything to come. No angels, no powers. Nothing. Psalms 139. Yeah? Oh Lord, You search me and You know me. Hear me. This is what He's done to you. There's no surprises with God about you. Oh Lord, You know me. You search me and You know me. You know when I sit down and You know when I rise up. Let me sit down. He knows it. Let me rise up. He knows it. I'll just sit down again. He knows it. I was rising. He knows it. You know, I love walking in the front door because I'm blessed going in. And I'm blessed going out. So I just go back in. I'm blessed going in. I'm blessed going out. I came into the city last night. I'm blessed in the city. I'm getting ready to go back out of the city. I'm going to go back out in the field. I'm blessed in the field. He's right there with me. He's right in the midst of my life. He's directing me. He's upholding me. He's keeping me. He's before me. He's behind me. He surrounds me. He's in love with me. He is celebrating me. Celebrating you. He's jumping up and down and going, I'm Your prize. I'm Your prize. I'm Your prize. I'm Your prize. I'm Your benefactor. I'm Your exceeding great reward. Why you got that frown on your face? Why you don't know how to enjoy Him? Can you just come to a place of enjoying Him and quit trying to be whatever? Because He's got a great way of making you what He wants you to be, with His own power, with His own supernatural authority. He calls His Holy Ghost to come upon you and create a new heart and a new spirit. And that's just the beginning. That's just the beginning. That's just getting you started. You know, we're overlooking at grandbaby. We're so captivated by Him. He's watching right now, probably sleeping. Ruth Anna said that this morning when I started preaching, he woke up because he's used to my voice. He's used to Papa preaching from the belly. So beautiful. We just stood there, stare at Him. Just staring at Him. Just so in love with Him. He ain't done nothing but just sit there and look. He ain't done anything. Just there. He just exists. That's how we are with a Father. That's how I am. That's my confidence. See, I know and believe the love that God has for me. I'm empowered there. I don't listen to what everybody else says. Everybody else got their comments. I don't even know comments from the peanut gallery. I don't need anybody's two cents. I don't need anybody else's word or theology or ideas. I'm not going to be fashioned after man. I know who God is. Amen. He revealed Himself to me through Jesus, through His word. Hallelujah. I can close my eyes and see him rejoicing over me. I can see him in the midst of my failure saying, I'm going to strengthen you. I'm going to perfect those things that concern you. Hey, come on now, listen to me. Huh? Listen to me. I see him in the midst of my shortcoming grabbing hold of me and saying, I'm going to make you mighty. I'm going to make you mighty. I'll make you valiant. Foolishness is bound in the heart of a child. The rod drives it far from it. And God's chastenings are good, but the bottom line of it is there's always love in it. There's always lots of love in it. Huh? And that chastening of Hebrews chapter 12 really comes down to being not willing to hear the instructions of the Lord. There's instructions saying, don't do that. Now, I love you. I'm going to look, we're here with you. I'm together with you in this. We can get this done. And then there is a continual, you know, not listening. Then there's a severity there. But let's not be that. Huh? Let's not be that. I know when you sit down. I know when you rise up. I understand your thoughts are far away. I understand your faraway thoughts. I understand your thoughts when you're thinking about something else that you might like to do and that you might like to be because you saw somebody else doing that. And it's not about me. Necessarily. Because really, he's talking about not that he sees our thoughts understands our thoughts from a far distance. It's really, he's talking about our distant thoughts from him. He's got a great response to those though. I can pass. You can pass my path and my lying down. Let me put it this way. You encompass or you surround where I go. Saying, hey, I'm here. Hey, I'm with you. Hey, hey. You surround everywhere I go. And when I lie down, you also surrounded me there too. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. If you ever go to bed and you have some worrisome thoughts, just get up and dance around for a little while and praise him. Sing a song. He's there. You just need to get hooked up with him. You're acquainted with all my ways. So there is not a word in my tongue, but lo, Lord, you know it all together. You have beset me or come in close to me or framed me about from behind. And in front of me, and you've laid your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. Because this is all in a very positive and a wonderful and glorious way where Father has come and set all of his delights upon us. Where he's come to fill us with his life, his abundant life, this glorious, overwhelming, beautiful thing of relationship and fellowship. See, now it's in this context that you and I will find ourselves, we'll discover ourselves to be so emboldened, so confident that all of a sudden we face some unclean spirit or some devil and we go, go now. Or we find some situation that opposes us and we're not hindered by it at all. It doesn't even rate being on the radar. We just step right over top of it. Now, every time God's ever given me faith, I've had people around me tell me why I can't do it. Because they're calculating. They're thinking, well, you got to do this, you got to do that. And go, no, I don't have to do any of that. You do that. I'm going to go do this.
And they're sitting over there going, he's going to fail, miserably fail. And they're like, wow, you're so lucky. No, it's not luck. It's just fellowship. It's relationship. And it's just moving with God. It's just an intimacy. God, I want to do whatever you want me to do. Father, whatever you want me to do. Father, I'll do whatever you want me to do. I whispered to the Lord one day and said, Father, if you want me to stay in San Diego, give me this property. Within less than a week from that whisper, the door was open to us. We were in the property. It's fellowship. I'm not trying to be that. I'm not trying to prove anything to anybody. Oh, I gotta prove something to the so-and-so so that they can recognize who I am in God. That's tainted. It's tainted with men's approval and with men's favor and seeking men's favor. This is intimate. This is secret. This is just between me and him. This needs to be just between you and him. This is the family relationship that we define as sonship. It's a family relationship that maybe it wasn't modeled right for you in your house. Maybe you did not have a dad that loved you so much that there was nothing that he wouldn't do for you. My children had the pleasure of that. My children had the blessing of that because there's nothing that I wouldn't do for them. There is nothing that I would withhold from them. One day, I thought about getting Joshua a truck, car, automobile. And I thought, well, I'll get him a used car. Now, you can't do this. You can't do this unless you step into the relationship. And the Lord said, no, he's worthy of far more than a used car. Get it new. So I didn't even have to calculate anything. I just said, I'm going to get a new car. And I didn't have the means or the wherewithal to get it, or maybe even the credit to get it. It just, I walked in there and the Lord did it because faith said, word said, did it, do it. Faith was there to do it. And I just functioned as a father for my son to give him the best. Not secondhand, not used. Father knows how to give us the kingdom. It's his good pleasure to give us the Holy Spirit. It's his good pleasure to give to us that which is most sacred to him. No special classes, no special status. Everybody, anybody, anywhere, whosoever will receive, whosoever will believe. Come on, that's not a caste system in the kingdom of God. It's not anything other than a sonship relationship that God has given where we know that we are his children. And more than just his children, we are those endowed with divine power and ability as his partners, as those that are in doing his business and doing his work on his behalf. I'm not working for God. I'm doing his work. Do you understand me? See the confidence that comes, the boldness that comes. Just knowing that we've been empowered, he's entrusted these things to us. Now you get to start enjoying them. Because I'm a son or you're a daughter. Or we're his family. We're in his house and he's happy with all of us. He's not like, man, I can't believe I had that child. Don't look like me. He's not that way. There's things that steal the confidence. There's no question about it. There's things that will disrupt that flow, that Father, of his love and intimacy with him. And we've got to recognize what those things are and say, look, I'm not having that in my life. It's displeasing to the Father. It violates what Father wants for my life, how he wants to function and flow
in my life, how he wants to use me, how he wants me to be his representative. But he still is just as passionate about me. He still loves you and me just as much. When we blow it and when we violate these things, he's just as passionate about getting us established in the right way. And he will perfect those things that concerns us. He'll put within our heart the way he feels about everything that we encounter. And he's amazing, isn't he? He's amazing. This is faith. The faith, the trust, the confidence towards God, a boldness, a certainty, to where that we know that we are entrusted with by God, empowered by him in such a way that nothing is impossible for us. And we understand that he's purposed to bring us before kings and before leaders of government and place us as the head and not the tail and bless us and give us favor in every dimension of life. But what happens is this goes on. People, all of a sudden, they get their hearts wrapped up in their little job. And they begin to define themselves because they can push a button and a little thing comes out. Or they can turn a knob and a little song starts going. That's about your vocation. I can push this button. And that's who I am. That's what I do. I push the button, the thing pops out. I've got this special skill set and everybody's enamored by it. Or I've got this special skill set and I'm the only one enamored by it. And I just want to make the height of what men can endow you with to be equal to pushing a button and something pops out. Because think about it, what lasting value is there in the things that I'm doing? Is there an eternal value in it? Is it something that God has defined for my life in the identity that I've received in Christ Jesus and the endowment of the Holy Ghost that has been supplied to me to be able to go and loose the heavy bands, to take those who are afflicted and tormented and bring them into a place of peace and rest, to let the oppressed go free, to feed the hungry, to minister to the needs of people spiritually where they're at, bring them out of the deception and out of the torment and out of all the stuff that is not only going to keep them from God right now, but for eternity they will be cut off from the land of the living, from knowing him. Think about that. Think about it, people. Let's just let God talk to us here. Step up and show us. Because this confidence towards God, this intimacy, this fellowship, this knowing that he hears us is you and I responding to him and being fully vested in that which he has called us to be and that which he's said that we are. That this is where we draw all of our value and our meaning and this is all of our delight. And now you can be whatever here and be right in the middle, in the center of the will of the Father, laboring to reach the lost, to set people free by the power of the Holy Ghost. Jesus said, if I work miracles and cast out devils by the Holy Ghost. Jesus is saying, he's not even doing it. He said, I'm doing it by the Holy Ghost. He said, it's not me that does the work. It's the Father that is in me. Look at this. If I do this by the Holy Ghost, if all of a sudden our life and the value and the meaning of our life is that we learn how to function in the wisdom that God gives, the competence that God gives to move and operate in the Holy Spirit, to be able to deal with the afflicting, tormenting, deceiving, lying, mind-blinding spirits that torment men all around us. We just learn the wisdom of God. Oh, what great liberty would come through your life. And in your lifetime, to maybe tens of thousands of people. Because you don't do it after your own understanding anymore, because you recognize you cannot do anything. But push the button, watch the thing pop out. Turn a little knob and music comes up. Because you've learned something that you can train a chimpanzee to do. Basically, no. No, I was sitting in a meeting one day. Dr. Gorbachev, who was the head of the biotech company that I worked for, and I were meeting with Dr. Hensley at Point Loma. And they were going to give a grant to Point Loma Medical, to Point Loma Pre-Med Department. That's what they were considering. So he was describing to him what he wanted to do. And Dr. Gorbachev looked at me and said, well, do you think that they have the equipment and the kind of resources and to do this? Because he just wants to bring me into conversation. Dr. Heasley got a little offended by the fact that Dr. Gorbachev looked to my advice about whether or not he could do it. And so he broke out into this rant about you could train a chimpanzee to do this. He lost the grant. Right there. Got a little irate. But he was right. You could. You could. You could. You could. He was trying to really overemphasize the skill set that he could push the button and the little thing would pop out. Father's vested us with an identity that we've failed to look upon. He's given to us a most unspeakable gift. Huh? He's given us an opportunity to function and flow in the riches of His glory. He's given us the opportunity to move in the manifested power of the Spirit of the living God, to where people look into our lives and they see something far greater, far more glorious than they saw in Joseph. They don't see a distant look, a distracted look. They don't see the face of humanity. They see the face of authority and power in your life. There's a big difference. Spirit of poverty can be recognized by most people from an outward, just an outward display of the way they act, what they have, the way they dress. You know what I'm saying? Spiritual poverty can also be seen. And Father wants you and I to be clothed with His majesty and functioning in the riches of His glory, but we've got to fully buy into the identity that He's given to us, the call that we have, the confidence that we have in Him, that we are His habitation, that we are His dwelling place, that we're in partnership with Him, that He's endowed these things to us, that He's empowered us to be this. This is faith. This is agreement. This is confidence. This is where I am right now, you right now, are truly being developed to speak to mountains and tell them to get out of the way. To stand before the tomb, the sepulcher, where the body stinks, and say, Lazarus, come forth. To be invited to come and speak at the funeral. And you give the dead body back to the person who lost it. You come with a special message for the funeral. Resurrection life. Oh, masitayo putorotai. We made the work of the life and the ministry of Jesus. We've so reduced it to other expressions. So many people don't even know what it means anymore. To live the life of Jesus. To function His divine power and authority. He wants to train you. Where's He going to train you? Worship. Enjoying Him. Believing Him. Saying, Father, what You made me to be and what the opportunity that You've given to me, I'm going to tell You. I don't want any of this. Ann and I were visiting baby. And so, we did something I don't really like to do on Sundays, and that is go into a place of business. Even a store, I don't like to. We did. We walked in the store. Unfortunately, just a God denying they're going to be open anyways. But just still, going in there, you're supporting somebody to have to work on Sunday and being kept back from possibly having an encounter with God in a church service. And there's no better place to have an encounter with God. It's not to say that this is the only place you can have an encounter. But as I'm walking into this place, there was all this opulent wealth around. in La Jolla. And I'm like, Father, the riches that you have for me is so far greater than all of this. I want nothing. I want none of it to ever cleave to me or be of interest to me. Huh? It's this Holy Ghost response in our line to all the various different things that we're encountering, because everything around us is vying for our affection. It's vying for our attention. It's vying for our passions. It's vying for our life. He wants to consume us. Why don't you get consumed on the altar? Why don't you get consumed? What better thing could you be doing with your life than living the life of Jesus? What greater possibility of a vocation could any of us be called into than the place of being seated together with Christ Jesus in a heavenly realm? Not pretend, but for real. For real, not for pretendies, for realies, for real, really, we really are. If I wanted to develop this confidence, if all the other interests vies for your affections, vies for your attention, makes you proud of you, makes you boast of you, it's gonna mess with this confidence, this certainty, this identity. This is who I am. This is what I do. What do? Miracles. What a great response, eh? What do? Miracles. What's that? Jesus ministry. Oh, yeah. That's a lot of people's response, right? Would you like to have some ministry? Well, what do you mean? Will God do anything for you? What do you have need of? Now they'll start melting. Yeah, the Spirit of the Lord is there, they'll start melting. We want to come with some little canned speech. Generic brand of Jesus. A generic brand. God tailor-made this encounter for you. And He's tailor-made an encounter for everybody that you meet through you. Father is implanting these things into your spirit. He's producing the hunger in your life for them. He's going to redefine for you what it truly means to walk with Him. And you're going to discover yourself in God. I'm going to tell you right now, anything that He gives you will make room for you. In other words, everybody will notice it. Anybody gets around you, ooh. A man's gift makes room for him. And God is going to get, well, Father wants to give you a gifting. You take hold of it tonight. Don't you try to think it through. Don't you try to worry it through. Don't you try to beg it through. I'm tell you right now, you worship and you agree with God it through. You just say yes to Him. You say yes to what He's giving. You don't let anything interfere with that. You define all these things that would interfere with it as your enemy that you're at war against. And then having any more place in your life. Because this is who you are. Amen. Hallelujah. It's not hard to be used by God, people. It's not hard to be used by God. Thank you, Jesus. There's so many things right here in this ministry right now that you can be doing, that you can be using. So many different things. So many different things. So many. Where you can begin to learn how to host the presence of God better. Did you know that you get that you're the host of where He dwells? Did you know that you're the host? Your body is His temple. That you get to host Him. That if you can understand who He is and the manner of life, the style that He has, you can understand the person that you're interacting with, that you can be a better host of His glory in your being, that you can host Him and be a better host to the Holy Ghost, making room and place for Him as you gather together in a room or in a church service. You know who He is. You know His manner of life. You know those things that He participates with and those things that He won't have anything to do with. You know what He likes and what He doesn't like. I go to places all the time. They say, what kind of food do you like? We want to make sure that we have the kind of food that you'll eat. They want to be a good host. I want to know, Father, what is it that you want? Because we want to be good hosts to you. What manner of praise? What song would please you? I want you to start enjoying me, says the Lord. I want you to start rejoicing over me. I want you to joy and rejoice, hallelujah, in this life that I've given to you, in this fellowship that I've entrusted to you. I want you to become emboldened in the identity and the empowerment that I have given to you. This is what Papa's saying. I love reading this verse of scripture. I'm reading to you quickly. Galatians chapter 4. Hallelujah. See, I'm in charge. I'm in charge. God put me in charge. God put you in charge. You're in charge. You're in charge. He's endowed you with the ability. He's free. He's given you the freedom of His glory and of His life. He's given you the kingdom. He's given you the Holy Ghost. He's made you His heirs and His co-inheritors. He's made you His ambassadors and His representatives. He's entrusted you with all power and authority, the authority of sonship and the divine power to do the same works that He Himself does. You're His hand extended. His mouth is being heard in the ears of men. It's amazing. I believe this. This is my confidence. This is the realms of my authority. I enjoy it. I'm not hoping. I'm knowing. And Father's purpose to bring me into a greater knowing and bring me into a greater certainty. Whew. I love taking a child in my arms and seeing the child get healed. Hand back child parents. A friend of mine called me out the other day, said, hey, they took our child who was deaf, they took him to another specialist, and I think it was a university, at Yale. And now he's hearing all these sounds.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank
you. That's what sonship does. Sonship is so full of His love. If you learn how to cooperate with His love and His joy, miracles just happen. When you're confident towards God and there's no condemnation, miracles just happen. When you're bold instead of shamed, when you're in love instead of fear, miracles just happen. You're just in the miracle.
Yes, they do. Thank you, Lord.
You're going to have to start enjoying God. You have to start enjoying this relationship with Him. Worship comes easy. You move out of the culture of condemnation because you're always wanting things that are not right, desiring things that you know are wrong. Culture of condemnation. And trying to serve God because there's something wrong here. And the affections and their own desires. Rather, Father, why don't you give up in this place of being accepted in the beloved? Just, man, I love this life in God. I love this. It's a new definition. I don't need to act like the world. The world should be trying to pursue us. Saying, these guys got something, and where did they get that? How can they do that? Where did that sound come from? I've never heard that sound. I've never felt that glory, that presence. The church is so conformed to the world that the same sorrow and the same sadness, and in many respects to me, the same demon spirits that's on music of the world, I hear it on music that's supposedly worshiping the Lord, and I'm just grieved by it because it's the same thing, same spirit of the world. I need to act like the world, my goodness. Something wrong with that. Paul wants us to imitate him. You want to imitate him?
Yes.
I'm going to tell you. I was out working. Dirt was blowing in front of my face just the other day. And I commanded the wind to cease and stopped. I said, stop! Now! Stop! I'm done with this. Blowing my string lying around, throwing dust in my face. The weather's like, we can't help it that the weather's changing. Why don't you just go ahead and get, I mean, there was a time many years ago, fire was coming, one of the great fires of San Diego, and I was standing there saying, fire, you turn around. I mean, I was turning around for a few minutes there. I was getting all confident. Huh? I mean, you guys remember seeing me out there with my hand lifted up, the fire's going to obey me. Well, it didn't fully obey me. I got run off. But don't mean I'm not going to come back at it again. Why? Because I've got this authority in God. I'm going to step into this authority in God. I'm going to practice. Hallelujah. And I'm not going to feel less confident if the fire didn't obey me or if the wind didn't obey me. I mean, my sons, Daniel's watching right now. He's been around in situations with me where these, what they call the little dust devils, start coming. I just put my hand and it moves. It was coming right to us. Put my hand out and it goes the other way. Why? Because I have this authority. God, obey me.
Yes.
And of course, when you begin to get in this, you get confident about it. You're not just experimenting. You see this? No, it won't work. Come on, move. I mean, where do we, come on, where are we, come on. And you see somebody who's afflicted and tormented and demon possessed on the street, and you say, in the name of Jesus Christ, I set you free. I command you now, you go home, you get right with your parents, you get right with your family that you left. Now, in Jesus' name, see you later. How about that? Set people free on the streets. Sitting there talking to them because they're going to quote more scriptures than you ever memorized. It is crazy, isn't it? It's crazy, eh? I went to that thing. I had a downtown ministry many years ago, about 35 years ago. Whoa, I mean, I couldn't believe it. I mean, how much Bible these people knew. Then I learned that I could move in the Holy Ghost and the authority of Christ Jesus as an ambassador of God and tell people what's going to happen. The lost, especially, what Satan's got to do. I set you free right now. Now, if you want to go back to your prison, you can, but I set you free right now from your torment, from your affliction. Huh? Where you see somebody crazy on the street, somebody schizophrenic talking to themselves, you don't run from them, you run to them. Huh? Come on now.
Yes.
They got, you ever run across somebody, they got their face all painted white, you know, they're just all messed up, talking to everybody who's around. It's your opportunity. Yes. But if there's fear in your heart, there's uncertainty in your heart, you might as well stay home. Stay on the porch. Are you listening?
Yes.
Don't paddle out. You'll drown. Are you listening to
yes.
me? You understand what I mean?
Yes.
Father wants to give you great boldness. Develop in you a great confidence. Where? In worship. And enjoying his presence. And being his son. Being his child.
Yeah.
Having the identity that he's given to you and rejoicing in it. Instead of constantly letting it be challenged and constantly conflicting it with other interests. Listen to me, people. God's talking. God's looking for some people who go and do what he's commanded us to do. Be who he's created us to be.
Amen.
To show that the messianic age has come, that the Messiah has come, that Christ has come, that he now lives and reigns. And we right now are in the midst of his kingdom. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Showing forth his glory, showing forth his praises. Hallelujah. Being blessed with all spiritual blessings in a heavenly realm. Walking out the riches of this glory that we have in Christ Jesus. Showing forth this power of his divine nature, shining like the light into the world, like the sun in the brightness of noonday. Put your sunglasses on because I'm coming. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. You need to get yourself into some prayer and fasting. So then when somebody starts having you pray, all of a sudden the atmosphere starts changing when you start speaking. Things start moving around. I was in a place the other day, and as soon as I started speaking, everybody was fine. As soon as I got up and started speaking, they started wiggling. I said, you just go ahead. You might as well strap. I see you wiggling. You might as well strap yourself in because it's going to get worse from here on in. You're going to get more uncomfortable as I talk. And I'm telling you, the wiggling went. Huh? Because the devil knew he had to go. He knew he had to leave. Hallelujah. I grabbed a couple of those wiggle worms. Hallelujah. And just with a simple, go free. Hallelujah. 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 Anything that doesn't release when I say so, it's fake. Are you listening to me? It's fake. It all has to obey. It's pretending. It's pretending. It's acting like it didn't go. Huh? It's a confidence. It's an authority. It's a certainty. Father wants us to rise up in it. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Every experience works confidence. Come on. Instead of the opposite. Instead of every experience working more insecurity and uncertainty, every experience works confidence. Hallelujah. Some of you are going to do some mighty acts tomorrow.
Yes.
Father's preparing some of you for some mighty acts. He's building you up in the faith right now with his word. Just go do some mighty acts. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I'm going to just stare at you because some people I'm looking at, I'm like, I'm getting depressed looking at them. No, I'm not. I'm not getting depressed. I would have to change the sermon. I'd have to change the message. And I'm not going to change the message. I'm not going to come to the doubt and to the unbelief. I'm going to stay in the faith. We'll have to give you a doubt and unbelief message some other time. Get you out of your doubt and unbelief. Tonight, this is moving in faith. It's understanding the relationship that produces faith. God called you and elected you to bring you into a place that whatever, a relationship with him, that whatever you ask him, he will do it. This is the fruit that Father wants in your life. That's what he said. John 15:16. He said, you did not choose me, I chose you. And I called you and I elected you to bring forth fruit. Huh? I called you and ordained you to bring forth fruit. A fruit that the cares of this life and the deceitfulness of riches and the pleasures of this world and compromises and conflicts will choke. And it won't produce. A fruit that whatever you ask the Father in my name, it will be done. Whatever. If you know that he hears you, then you know that you possess whatever you ask for. And when you're about the Father's business, I know that you always hear me, Lord. I understand how to not move ahead of you. I not understand the moving direction. Hey, come, hurry, pray for my brother. He's sick. Human compassion and a sense of demand. Oh, this is my responsibility. After all, I pray for the sick. It's not on you. Holy Ghost direction is on you. You just move on. And you wait, because God's going to do something bigger. And then 3 days later, you say to the disciples, hey, Lazarus is sleeping. Let's go wake him up. And the disciples are just like you and me. They don't get it. Well, if he sleepeth, he doeth well. If he's asleep, he's doing good. Why would we want to go wake him up? And you get there. If you would have been here, he wouldn't have died. If you would have just listened. To just begin to believe and understand that the resurrection and the life lives in us. And our whole life is about showing forth that life and that resurrection power. And that faith and that divine authority. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Galatians chapter 4. Paul says an explanation of what it means to be an heir of God. Because he's, you know, already laid this down to the Romans. In Romans chapter 8, beginning of verse 14, he begins to lay out what it means to have the witness that you are a son of God, that you walk in the Holy Ghost, that you walk in the Spirit, that you don't have the spirit of fear anymore. You're not in bondage anymore, but you have the spirit of sonship whereby you cry, Abba, Father. And he's expressing this great confidence and this great authority and this great liberty now that we've been released from the law of sin and death and are walking in the glorious laws of the Spirit of life that is in Christ Jesus. Walking in a whole new definition of what it means to be alive and to exist. And there in this testimony of being led in the Spirit, walking in the Spirit, learning how to move with the Spirit, because it takes wisdom and understanding to move with the Holy Ghost. God wants to give it to us. It takes a devotion and a dedication. I want to learn this and I want to learn it right. And I want to learn it your way as you teach it, oh God. Oh, my. Thinking about the reality that Father wants to show us things that no one has ever seen, cause us to hear things that no one has ever heard. I'm interested. I believe that. That is for real to me. To understand things that cannot enter into the human heart, cannot be written in any book or found in any library on the earth. It's not within the framework of the wisdom of men. God wants to come and reveal these things to us by the Holy Spirit. He wants to come and take everything that belongs to the Father, and he wants to show us, and there's things that we're going to have to begin to believe and agree with God and understand about God in order to be able to receive it. It's taught to you and me in a lavish display of enjoying God.
Yes.
Of enjoying him.
Amen.
Of being caught away in his love, captivated by his presence, being willing to break through anything that tries to stop or prevent that in your life. Because sometimes you have to run through a troop and leap over a wall. Sometimes you have to deal with spiritual wickedness that would try to prevent you. Sometimes you have to deal with physical ailments and sleepiness and all and you know, maybe even diseases. But the Lord will make you excellent at it. Paul says, now, I say that an heir, as long as he's a child, he's talking about people that are under the law. They differ nothing from a servant, though they be Lord of all. They were called to something glorious and wonderful, and display of the power and the majesty of the living God, but they haven't stepped into it yet. They just see it from afar off. But those children are under tutors and governors until the time appointed of the Father, until they get old enough and they passed the test, as it were, and developed enough in the family business and enterprise to now to be entrusted as the one who's taking the reins of the company, as it were. Even so, when we were children, we're in bondage under the elements of the world. Once again, children in bondage under the elements of the world because of the law that ultimately was a testimony that men were still held under the power and the stronghold of sin and death. They had not been liberated by the new birth, the new creation yet. They've not been made a new man, a born again child of God, a new creation, one partaker of the divine nature, a habitation of the living God, where God the Holy Ghost dwells. But when the fullness of time has come, God sent his Son, made of a woman, made under the law, to come liberate us. Amen. To come bust us out. Come release, day of release, the day of trumpet blast, the day of inheritance being restored back again to every man, that which God endowed each person with. What he already defined, as it were, you and I to be in an Adam that never sinned nor rebelled, but greater now because of redemption. I want you to break free of your identity, of the culture and the things that have surrounded you, that have captured you, that have infected your life and heart and values, and step into this place that goes on throughout the ages, this place in Christ Jesus, this reigning with him that gets bigger. It's eternal in the heavens. It's the heavenly gift that you have tasted of, having been made partakers of the Holy Ghost, partners with him, joined together with him in your spirit, heirs together with the living God, having tasted of the good word of God and of his power. Yes. What an encounter. What an endowment. Everything about you will steal that from you. Everything about you in this world and all that you have allowed and accommodated that does not belong to Father, that does not belong to the Holy Spirit, will steal what I just said from you. It will steal your confidence. It will steal your boldness. With it, it will steal your certainty. It will steal who you are supposed to be, what God created you and I to be, the power and the authority expressed within our life. It's time to come out from among them. Come out of Babylon. Come out of Babylon. Come out of Babylon. Come out. Come out of Babylon. Come out. Come out of Babylon into this inheritance, into this dwelling, into this habitable place, into this wonderful land of paradise. All of this divine race, of these children and heirs of God, functioning in the authority of the living God, walking in the spirit of truth, living by the word of God, living under the reign of his glory, functioning in the rivers of the Holy Ghost,
walking in the anointing that breaks off every yoke, that removes every hindrance out of the way, so that there is a continual flow of His divine presence, of His manifested glory, of this divine excitement, of this exceeding joy, of this love unspeakable, undefinable, that passes knowledge. This peace that passes understanding. This realm of the divine, this realm of the heavenly, this realm of the holy, this realm of pleasure evermore.
Hallelujah.
Come out of Babylon, your captivity is over. Step into your inheritance, says the Lord. Come out from among them and be ye separate, says the Lord. And it's really what Paul preached. It's what he preached in 2 Corinthians chapter 6, because he took it right from the prophet that applied it to Babylon. When he said, come out from among them, be separate, says the Lord. Mama city first. Heaven's here. God's talking to you. He surrounds you. He is before you. He's framed you in, and He's before you and behind you. He surrounds you when you sit down. He surrounds you when you lay down. And lo, there's not a word in your mouth, except for He's perfectly aware of it. Jesus. Jesus. I so want to get it, Lord. And I so thank You for the revelation of it, and it is so simple. It's all defined in love and enjoying the relationship. Wow. That the great miracles and signs and wonders, is found in the peace and in the joy. My, what a plan. What a discovery. What a revelation. The only thing that's holding you back is the fact that you're not getting happy enough. The only thing that is holding you back is the fact that you're not walking in love and willing to just express the wonderful grace and goodness of God to those that are around you. My, what a plan. His faith, His power, His glory, His fullness released in the midst of love. His signs and His wonders revealed as someone gets ecstatic. As someone gets ecstatic, they begin to become exceedingly joyful. They become ecstatic. Amen. This is true. It is repulsive to the framework of the human mind until all of a sudden the miracles start happening. Then everybody's going, what is this? I actually want what Elijah had, not what Solomon had. Think about it. With all that God gave him, wisdom above all other men, he destroyed God's kingdom. In one generation, he destroyed God's kingdom. Single-handedly, with that wisdom, he built it up to its zenith, as it were, and then destroyed it. Think about it.
I'm going to enjoy the Lord. Come on, people. Come on now. Papa put some celebrate in you. Papa put some celebrate in you. I'm going to wake up in the morning to Miracle Monday with some celebrate. I'm going to go over on into Tongues of Fire Tuesday with some more celebrate. I'm going to be in Wonderful Works Wednesday expecting some unbelievable things. I'm telling you, I'm just warming up to what we're going to do in God. Amen. Thanksgiving Thursday is going to come so quick. And I'm going to ask God, oh Lord, slow it down just a little bit so I can make sure that I'm fully captivating all that you meant me to have, functioning all that you've given, all that you're teaching. Step into fire, God, Friday, fully developed. Amen.
Amen.
Come on now, can you hear me? Can you hear me? Can you hear me? I so blessed see two people have taxi cabs to heaven signs. You know, that's a blessing. You know, you don't have to have them all week long necessarily, but I think it's really good. Huh? Taxi cab to heaven. Can I hitch a ride? No telling what people are going to say to that. I hope more than two of you grabbed a hold of Miracle Monday and started believing for miracles on Monday. I hope that more than two of you grabbed a hold of Tongues of Fire Tuesday and started developing for Wonderful Works Wednesday and started defining days. Hey, listen, you come up with your own, but I'm going to tell you right now, you're going to work hard to come up with something better than that. Yeah, that's good. You know, those are good. You say Marvelous Monday, it still ain't as good as Miracle Monday. And you said Miraculous Monday, you just said the same thing I said. You're just trying to be different. If you said Monumental Monday, it still wouldn't be good as Miracle Monday. So I'm going to tell you, listen, just hang it, just go with it. Why don't you just go with this? Why don't you find somebody who's got an expression of enjoying God, start acting like them. Quit trying to be whoever it is you are being. You know what I'm saying? Act like Anna. Follow her. I've been so blessed watching Kristen up there. Joshua. Find those people excited about God and passionately. Just, were they for your entertainment? No, just start imitating. Be followers of their faith. How long you got to stare at something before you can act, do what that, and you know, come on. How long you got to stare at something before you can respond? Come on. It isn't that hard. And it's a connectivity that God wants. I'm staring at Jesus on the pages of the Bible. Say, Lord, I want to do that. I'm gonna imitate that. Instead of intimidate that, I'm gonna imitate that. I'm gonna do it just like you did it. That's what Elisha did concerning raising the dead boy. He imitated Elijah. And then in the midst of that, God gave him a special revelation on how to just add something to it and do it a little different. But he started with the imitating it. Can you hear me?
Yes.
To redeem them that were under the law, that we might receive sonship. In the receiving of sonship, there is a great authority. When you've been endowed with authority, you have a confidence and a boldness and a certainty because you have authority. It's yours. You're not trying to have it. You're not trying to gain an approval. You're not trying to get an acceptance. You have received sonship.
As many as would receive, he gave them the authority to be sons. You received sonship. With it came an authority. By this reception of what God has given, in the new birth, in the new creation, to have received eternal life means that you were born again. Means that you stepped into divine sonship. It is a description of an intimate relationship where you were actually spiritually begotten of God. Oh, if that would no longer be conflicted and compromised by other earthly and worldly interests, you would step in very quickly to a greater display of the splendor and the beauty of the Spirit of the living God. What will you do with this message tonight? Because the Spirit of the Lord, the finger of the Lord is here writing. And he wants to write the pages of his life. He wants to write the pages of his will. He wants to write the pages of his love. Written upon the tables of your heart and seen in the expressions of your face. Will you be willing to enjoy him? Will you be willing to delight yourself in him? Will you be willing to come and drink from the waters that causes you to enjoy the pleasures forevermore and the fullness of joy of this relationship? Where you see him before you and on your right hand that you should not be moved? Where you stand in his presence and behold his glory, enjoying this relationship, enjoying it. Just, it's done. It's done, because he said so right here. The creative word of God said so. The living word of God, the powerful life and spirit word of God said so. When you agree with God's word, the Holy Ghost comes. Amen. And makes it all manifest in your life. And because you are sons, he sent forth the Spirit of his Son into your heart, crying, Abba, Father. You've been released from the bondage of fear. He's just really repeating his message in Romans chapter 8 in many ways. Just framing it up, setting in a little bit different setting, so that the hearer would be able to understand this is the gospel message. It's the gospel message to the Romans. It's the gospel message to the Galatians. It's the gospel message to the Ephesians. It's the gospel message to the Philippians. It's the gospel message to the Corinthians. It's the gospel message to the Philippians. Did I say that? It's the gospel message to those of Thessalonica. It's the gospel message to those at Colossae. It's the gospel message to you who believe. Well, I discovered it a long time ago in God. I was, maybe you've heard me tell this story, but they've never really put it to practice and imitate it. And I won't pray that tonight that would change. And it would change on every level. You'd imitate it even in easier circumstances. But I got terribly sick. This was before I stepped in to living in divine health, which I've enjoyed for many years. And what a wonderful realm. And when you get in this realm, if you do something to violate it, I'm telling you right now, it's like somebody stabs you in the heart with a hot knife, and they put, 500 tons of weight upon your chest, and you repent quickly, and you know quickly, because it's right in the middle of you maybe thinking something or saying something, because God puts a rain upon you because you're willing. You're willing to give yourself to it. I'm not exaggerating. I'm just trying to relate the impact of it. And I pray you experience it on your own quickly. But I was terribly sick. I was so sick, my eyelashes hurt. I was so sick that it was impossible for me to move anything. It was difficult to breathe. And suddenly it came to me in the spirit that Jacob lay a dying, and he rose up and leaned upon his staff and worshiped. And I recognized as I was laying there that after he had rose up from that deathbed and worshiped, that he lived many years afterwards. So I got up off of that sick bed and I began to worship. And it started like, oh, dude. Because that's all I could grunt out. I worship you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. Oh.
For hallelujah.
Oh.
It did not take long, and I was jumping around that room. I was jumping up and down, praising him, enjoying his presence. Completely healed. Completely healed. Divine healing, the first onset of that terrible whatever thing it was. Completely, totally broken, completely healed. I found the glory of release and worship, enjoying his presence, breaking through whatever was holding me down and whatever was trying to impose upon me. Something different than me delighting in the Lord my God. From the wellspring. From the wellspring. Come on, say it. From the wellspring comes forth wild rivers. Come on now. You've got to give you more memory than that. Got to give you more revelation than that. You can hold on to the things. You won't forget the things that are important to you.
The Holy Ghost wants to not only bring to our remembrance everything that Jesus has spoken, and everything that we've heard spoken by the Spirit. By the Spirit of Jesus Christ. But show you things that man has never seen or heard nor understood, and take all the glory of the Father and display it, before your life as you worship, as you enjoy him. I'll be driving down the road tomorrow, and I know exactly what's going to happen. I'll start worshiping him, and I'll start enjoying him, and I'll bust through into a realm of divine glory. Driving down the road. Whatever, you just find it. Discover the place, discover the realm. You can always go there. And then every time you're going there, it's a greater depth. And now all of a sudden you've got a new desire, you got a new definition, you got a new value, you got a new meaning, you got a new feel, you got a new understanding, you've been there. Hey, wait a minute. Understand, guys, I went somewhere the other day that I've never been before. Hey, and I'm not staying. I know you're up in the mountaintops, you're upon the great heights in God, but hey, let's climb on up a little. I just went to a better view than you've ever seen. That's what Papa's doing. He's saying, come. Why live in the lowlands? Why live upon the rocky ledges of life? Sure, he'll give you a hind seat that your feet would not slip. But he's going to bring you up into the heights of his glory. In the habitable land. Hallelujah. Harastapora vinci kili mahaplaste. Hamritsitos inanaketishta. I'm about to try to wrap this thing up for you. But in all the talking and all the display and all of the ministry, you're supposed to be going somewhere in the spirit. It's not a story to entertain you like a movie that is on the television. It's the word of God seating you and a call of God pleading with you to come on into a realm. Respond. Consecrate yourself to a response. Say, Lord, I'm going to do that. Lord, I recognize the things that have gotten in the way. Because a lot of times when the Lord's presenting these things, God will begin to show you things that you've let get in the way. And if you sit there and try to figure out how it's not going to be in the way, guess what? You know what? You're your own Savior. So crown your own head and bow down to yourself in worship. Because it just doesn't work that way. When God shows you something, you just need to say, yes, Lord, I don't want that in my life anymore. I'm not going to have that in my life anymore. Thank you for coming and delivering me. Still save you, save me. If you're always retreating to your own mind, your own logic, your own understanding, you're just your own, you're your own God, man. And what a terrible kingdom to live in. And I promise you, you won't have many that follow you. Because they're going to end up in the same rut you in. But you let God be your Savior? Whoa. He'll deliver for you from every form of destruction, from every snare of the enemy. He'll show you a way, a path that was never defined before. He will reveal it. He will split the water. Amen. Everybody's sitting around going, how are we going to get through this situation? Father's brought us out here. We've got a river here. We got a sea here and an army there. We in trouble. Ruh-roh. We in trouble. Let's make some boats. You can hear them. Do we have enough wood? No, there's not enough wood. Well, there's enough wood for you and I to get away. I don't know about the other 3 million, but we can get away. Who knows, you know? People are people, no matter what generation you find them in. Got one person who's seen the glory, who's got a confidence and a boldness, who knows how to hear the voice of heaven, who says, stand still. Don't move. Quiet yourself. Quiet ourselves. Are you kidding me? There's an army barreling down on us that are going to kill us. And you're saying, quiet yourself. It's either army or drown. And you're saying, quiet yourself. What a preacher. What kind of pastor? Who elected him? This guy is absolutely nuts. Quiet yourselves. Because people are the same in every generation. I can't even believe his plan. Can you even believe he brought us out? Who elected him? He says he's anointed. Listen, God's smarter than this. He brings his people and traps them. Who would lead us to a dead-end road? Who would lead? He doesn't have the leadership of the Holy Ghost. He's brought us to a dead-end road. We gotta go find another way around this big OC. Stop thinking. Stop trying to figure it out. Stop being your own savior, your own rescuer. Follow God. Even though it looks like a dead end. Just follow God. Just follow him. Say, God said, walk over here. Oh, there's just a big OC over here. Well, what are we supposed to do now? Stand still. And behold the salvation. Behold the salvation of the Savior. Behold your Savior. Behold the deliverance of God. Behold the one who makes a way where there is no way. Who discovers a path that no man has ever walked upon before. You're faced with the same thing. You're faced with the same thing. Many of you face the same things tonight. And it really is a part of why you can't just hook up with the flow and just go there, because you're compromised, you're conflicted. God challenges you at points and you start thinking about, well, I've got to change this and I've got to readjust this and how I'm going to do that. And what does this mean? How does that fit into my life? I need a practical understanding of it. Would you please be quiet? Would you make that your enemy and fight against it? Would you bring all your power and authority of God in bear and stop that thing now? Well, what do you mean, Pastor? Stop that thing now. Those thoughts, those reasonings, those paths that your feet have trod all your life. throw your hands up in total to surrender and say, let's watch what God will do, because I'm going all the way with Him. I'm not living the way I've lived anymore. I'm not compromising. I'm not going to have conflicts. I'm not going to try to figure it out. I'm going to enjoy God. Wouldn't it be wonderful if they would have broke the tambourines out up front? Right before the seas parted, they would have already broke out the tambourines. The Lord has delivered us from the horse and the rider. Huh? It's okay. At least they broke the tambourines out after the departing. Amen. It just that within 2 days, they were back into their mess. They were right back into their mullet grubs. Where is God? Where are the promises? Where? Have you forgotten so soon? Forgotten what? How do we know that really happened? Because you're here. Men haven't changed. It's time with total abandonment that each one of us just jump into what God has said and say, this is who I am. And this is what I'm going to be. And this is how I'm going to live. And what He said is mine. And His banner over me is love. And I'm my beloved's, and He is mine. Ha, He is the vine, I am the branch. Just start enjoying God. Yes, Jesus. There's a shout. There's a shout in the house. There's a praise to be released. Therefore, you're no more servant, but your son. And if you're son, then you're an heir of God. That's the realm of faith. That's the realm of confidence. That's where you say to the mountain, move. That's where you say to the devil, go. That's where you say to the dead, be raised to life again. You're good. That's where you say, money, come. That's where you begin to send forth faith as a servant to do your bidding. That's where you begin to speak to nations, situations, sickness, disease. Death, famine, affliction. Mambrasa vitikida banamatapetisht. Mimbros bravara makidisht prebevetis ipalodu bahala. Mimbrevete kisiatalodumasapretisis. Mimbrata karadis teaches how to talk properly. Sebedevitikalamana mosisi. So what are you doing? I'm in training how to speak. Bikarobosiara than a mamatisibla. How to order my conversation right. I want you to stand with me. Now, let me tell you something. Some of you have a limited ability to receive tonight. There's various different dimensions of how you receive, and it's all a function of how you enjoyed God during the time that we were worshiping. It's all a function of it. And I want you to begin to experience it and explore it. I would even say experiment, but there's something deeper than that. Jesus, 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 Jesus. Don't make worship complicated. Don't make it complicated. Make it easy. Make it easy. Make it easy. Do not make it complicated. Not in any kind of expression, not in any kind of motion or action or activity. Let it just explode. Phew. Let these things explode in your life. You know, when Jesus said in Mark chapter 11, verse 24, if you believe that you've received them, then whatsoever you say, it will be yours. It's yours. That is all within this context of a relationship of a father and a son who's been fully vested already with all that heaven has, with all that Father has entrusted. It is a response in many respects to just simply maturing as a son. It's just a natural response is just something that just naturally happens out of this enjoyment in this relationship and fellowship with God. It's not something you try, well, if I just don't have doubt in my heart. Well, if I can just by some kind of human reasoning lay hold on this. No, it's just a natural consequence of this fellowship that I've been talking to you about tonight. Therefore I say to you, whatsoever things you desire when you pray, believe that you receive them and they're yours. It's a confidence. It's an uncompromised relationship of who you are because of what God has done for you in the generosity of His love and of His goodness. You're the offspring of God. You're part of His family. He did it. He decided it. He made it happen. And it is glorious. And I see some of you receiving a faith and anointing to function as, because you hear me, only God can produce this. And He looks for a ready heart. That's all. He looks for a ready heart. You cannot create this. You cannot produce this. You cannot make it happen. You respond in obedience to God with a ready heart, with a hungry heart. God works a miracle, just like the new birth. He works a miracle. He comes and He works a miracle. And He puts it on the inside of you. And you feel it and it begins to flow and it begins to overwhelm you. And it's a knowledge too high for us. We can never grasp it. We can never have it of our own. We can never create it within ourselves. We just get ready. We respond to the Word. Cry of a heart begins to be Holy Ghost now. Holy Ghost, Holy Ghost, Holy Ghost now. Jesus, I thank you. Jesus, I praise you. Holy Ghost, Holy Ghost, Holy Ghost now. Father, I worship you. Father, I thank you. Father, I praise you. Holy Ghost now. Holy Ghost now, Holy Ghost now. Holy Ghost, Holy Ghost, Holy Ghost now. I look unto the author and finisher of my faith. I began in the Spirit and I can only be completed by the Spirit. I can only have these encounters with God, but I'm longing for the encounter with God. I'm enjoying the fellowship. I'm enjoying the relationship and I'm longing for an encounter. I'm longing for that thing that only God can do. I'm not stuck in my own figuring it out. I'm not stuck in the sense of somehow failing and not measuring up, not meeting up, not doing enough. I'm not there. I'm just not there. I'm over here and enjoying this fellowship, this abundant life, living this thing that God has given me, hungry for the encounter, desiring a higher height, a deeper depth.
Thank you, Jesus.
It's the transition, people. You were raised in a culture, in a world, in a society designed by demon spirits that it's made it all about what you can do and what the arm of flesh can produce, what you can make happen. You've lived on praise, or you've lived on a sense of failure, acceptance, and doing well, you feel good, and doing bad, you feel bad, and it's all about what you do. And that's not the way the kingdom works. Father came, our Savior, He rescued us. He's come as our Savior to lead and guide us. He retains all rights and powers to revelation. In wisdom and insight, you can have none without Him unless He gives it. You cannot hate evil unless He gives it to you. You cannot love righteousness unless He gives it to you. He gives it. You cannot move in faith unless he gives it. You cannot move in the heavenly gifts unless he gives it to you. It's an encounter. He empowers you. He does it. He does the work. Without him, it cannot be done. Having begun in the Holy Spirit, you must rely upon only the Holy Ghost if you're ever going to mature. Blessed is the man who makes God the sole object of his trust. And Father's going to work it all right out in that dimension of how you trust him, of how you agree with him, of how you rely upon him, and all the milieu of all the decisions and all the things that's going on in your life every day. He tries your heart. He sees what's in you. He's waiting for you to stand still. He's waiting for you to look to him. He's waiting for you to say, I'm done. I want to move with you now. Because you can't move forward in you. You can only move forward in God. You can't go to deeper depths and higher heights because of your own arms of flesh, because of your own strength, because of your own talents, because of your own skill set, because of your own ability to push the button, the thing pops up. It's the encounter. Supernatural encounter. And this encounter's here. The encounter's here right now. Sound from heaven's here right now. There's a sound from heaven. There's a sound. I'm stirred with the sound right now. That's why I'm sitting down at instruments playing, and I'm stirred. I'm stirred with the sound. There's a sound. A sound. I'm earnest for it. It's attention. I'm eager for it. It's something God's earnest to do. It's something he wants to happen. He wants to make it happen. He wants to do it. And if you look for yourself to do it, you can't do it. You gotta learn how to wait upon him, and you press in for it. Wait upon him. I want to hear the sound. I want to hear the sound of God. I want to hear the sound. I want to hear the sound. I want the encounter. I want to move with you. I want your movings of God. I look to you, Lord. Only you can make this a reality. Only you can cause the deaf to hear, the blind to see. Only you can raise the dead to life again. Only you can give understanding and revelation. Only you can make my heart to know. Only you can train my ears to hear. Only you can give me spiritual insight that I may behold and look and see that there's more with us than are with them, that the heavens are filled with your glory. That there's a realm of faith to walk in, that I don't have to look to and rely upon my five senses. God would set you free from that stronghold so that you know that he hears you. That's seeing in another realm. And if you know that he hears you, at that moment in time, an event in your life, by the Spirit of the Lord, has called you to move from relying upon your five senses to a whole nother spiritual understanding. A whole nother world opens before you. It's peeled back like a curtain. You get to see. And Father looks, he tries the hearts, and he knows whether or not you really want this. So he'll work with you till you really want this. He sees, he's working with you right now. Stirring you. God, the Holy Ghost is stirring you. You're thinking, could it be possible? Could it be possible that God would take better care of me than I could take care of myself? Could it be possible that God would provide for me according to his riches and glory? Could it be possible that I too could step up and begin to take nations and see the multitudes of people delivered from disease and sickness and torment and death and an eternity without God? The Lord looks at us all the time and he says, do you love the fish more than you love souls? Do you love the fish more than you love me? Do you love your occupation and the means that you come to rely upon for provision for you and for your family, the trade that you learned from your father. You love it more than me. He tries us. He tries us. He asks us questions. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father, for this church, for this place, for this people. That there's even this number of people that are willing to say, wait a minute. My life is more than clothing. My body is more than clothing. And my life is more than food. I'm an heir of God, entrusted with His divine power and authority to now be trained by the Holy Spirit to learn to walk in His divine glory. Being prepared by the Holy Ghost to know how to live in the manner of heaven and understand the proper conduct of a life that never ceases, eternal in the heavens.
Hallelujah.
Father wants to bring used to me. He doesn't want you to be like an ostrich. Not only buries the head in the sand, but buries the eggs, and no sooner does you bury her young and forgets that they belong to her. She has no understanding. Father wants you to fill you with His own wisdom and insight so that you quit making decisions based upon some temporal self-gratification that will perish with the using, and make that the value of your life and the importance of your time, the meaning of your existence. So many people have died. God's economy is far greater than the economy of men. I say that God's economy today, in the realms of heaven, is far greater than the economy that He had for His people in the days of the law, in the days of Israel. And look at the economy that He set for them and the blessing He placed upon them. But we can't have what we want and what He wants at the same time. He will not mix what He has with that, with humanity, will not mix it. Praise God that He comes, the Holy Spirit, and fills us with faith, fills us with wisdom, fills us with the spirit of revelation and wisdom and knowledge. The knowledge, the understanding of the Holy, the knowledge of God, the knowledge of Jesus Christ. Oh, from the rock. From the wellspring. Salvation. Put the words up. Some people don't know them. From the wellspring. From the rock. Salvation. What is that? That is a divine power of God at work and entrusted to us. That is at work in us and that comes to us. The encounters. A stirring.
stirring of confidence, a stirring of boldness, a stirring of revelation, a stirring of identity. Wait a minute, who am I? What will it look like? What will I stand and be the very moment that I breathe out this last breath and behold and see God as He is and behold myself and understand who I am in that place before Him? See that and recognize, no, I'm that now. To be no longer held in a prison to a culture. To be no longer held in the prison of that which a society demands. To no longer walk in the counsel of the ungodly. But to hear what Father said from heaven and to agree with Him. And just be it. And be so happy about it. Be so emboldened by it. Be so confident about it. This is the way it works here. I'm His ambassador standing in His stead. I'm the living epistle written of God, read of men. Oracle from heaven. Tell me what the dream is. God will show me. Give me just a minute and I'll give you a word of knowledge. Being as confident in the giftings and the workings of God as you are in your own memory and your own ability and the things that you're confident that you can do. Now all of a sudden you're confident in God and He will do it through you. It's yours. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. And just enjoy Him. Just enjoy. Just enjoy God. Just let me see you enjoy God. Just enjoy Him. Just begin to enjoy Him and enjoy His presence and enjoy this fellowship.